so you went to the Caribbean for your holiday then?
Not exactly.
The Cayman Islands, the other side of the Caribbean.
The most basic financial impulse of all is to save for a rainy day. Because, as we've been painfully reminded by the recent months of financial turmoil, the future is so unpredictable. The world really can be a dangerous place. Not many of us get through life without a little bad luck. Some of us get a lot. It's all about being in the wrong place at the wrong time. Like New Orleans, when Hurricane Katrina hit.
The question is, how should we deal with the risks and uncertainties of the future? Should the onus be on the individual to insure against disaster? Should we be able to rely on the voluntary charity of our fellow human beings when calamity strikes? Or should we be able to count on the state, in other words, the compulsory contributions of our fellow taxpayers, to bail us out when the flood comes?
That's a long way of asking a simple question. Are you insured? The British certainly think they are. Today, we pay a larger proportion of our income on insurance than any other people in the world. It's really rather odd, because Britain is one of the safest countries on Earth. The struggle to overcome risk has been a constant theme of the history of money. From the invention of life insurance by two hard-drinking Scots clergymen, to the rise and fall of the welfare state, to the explosive growth of hedge funds and their multi-billionaire owners. At the core of our struggle with risk is an insoluble conflict. We want to be financially secure, and so we yearn for a predictable world. But the future always seems to come up with new and unpleasant ways to take us by surprise. We want calculable risk. We're stuck with random uncertainty. When Hurricane Katrina hit New Orleans in the last week of August 2005, it caused death and destruction. Yet it's not a natural catastrophe that now threatens the survival of the city. The real lesson of the disaster is about money. How the risk management system we call insurance simply failed when faced with a calamity on this scale. The hurricane didn't hit New Orleans directly. The main force of the storm passed to the northeast of the city. But just as the residents breathed a sigh of relief, the real catastrophe began.
This industrial canal links Lake Pontchartrain to the Mississippi. And after the hurricane, the huge storm surge raised the water level in the canal so high that it broke the levee, pouring umpteen gallons of the lake over here into the Ninth Ward of New Orleans.
Just to the east of the Ninth Ward is St. Bernard, a blue-collar community of homeowners, all, on paper at least, covered by private insurance. Councillor Joey DeFatta refused advice to leave the city, staying put during the storm. Eventually, he was forced to retreat to the roof of the town hall as the waters kept rising.
And as you can see, this is the water line.
That's the water line.
That's where it came up to. The water came in this building in 14 feet of water in 15 minutes.
Wow.
From the second floor of this building, I could see coming down Judge Perez, a wall of water. In that wall of water was debris, cars, vehicles, pieces of roofs. And this wall of water, you guesstimate, had to be maybe 15 to 20 feet tall.
And moving fast.
Moving quickly, just coming down this boulevard street and just taking everything with it as it would come.
The whole of St. Bernard Parish was inundated in just 15 minutes. Only 5 houses out of 26,000 weren't flooded.
More than 2,000 people were killed in Hurricane Katrina and the subsequent flooding. Here in St. Bernard Parish, 148 people lost their lives, mostly because they became trapped in their houses as the floodwaters rose. The painted signs on these abandoned houses say whether dead bodies were found after the floodwaters receded, a little bit like medieval London in the time of plague.
Yet 3 years later, it's not flooding or plague that's killing New Orleans. A harsh financial reality has emerged. People can't live here anymore because they can't insure their homes. One man made it his mission to show the limits of private insurance when it comes to a really big crisis. He's former Navy pilot Richard F. Scruggs, one of those lawyers that only America seems to produce. Dickie Scruggs took $50 million off the asbestos industry, then $248 billion off tobacco companies for failing to warn smokers of the danger of lung cancer. This kind of work has its rewards. Scruggs's share in fees on the tobacco case was $1.4 billion. Scruggs's latest target has been America's insurance companies. His clients, hundreds of homeowners whose houses were destroyed by Katrina, argued that the companies were refusing to pay up on genuine claims, a view the insurers disputed.
There was a house there?
There was a house here, a house next to it, where you see the trailer.
Scruggs had a dog of his own in this fight.
This house looks like it's...
His own home on Pascagoula's Beach Boulevard, here on the Mississippi coast, was so badly damaged by Katrina that it had to be demolished.
This is
the front door?
This is the front door, right here. The edge of the slab, if you will.
You were slabbed?
Good and proper. We were slabbed.
If you could fix the system.
But I have the means, I'm fortunate enough that I have the means to...
To lose a house and build it back.
To lose a house and build it back. Most people here don't.
Right. If you had the power to change the system so that people really were insured, how would you do that? Is there a way of making insurance work again?
There is, and it's disclosure of what you're buying, so that you know, like a drug, there's a black box warning on there. This is what it does, this is what you should watch out for, as opposed to this device which is called the modern insurance policy, which no one can interpret or understand.
It seemed as if the insurance companies had been well and truly scrugged. One of America's biggest insurers settled hundreds of cases brought by Scruggs on behalf of clients whose claims had been turned down. But in this bitter high-stakes battle, the insurance companies had the last laugh. After winning the case, Scruggs was convicted and sentenced to 5 years for attempting to bribe a judge and influence the distribution of legal fees. And the big insurance companies responded to the weight of post-Katrina claims by in effect declaring parts of the Gulf Coast a no-home insurance zone. Today, as Councillor Joey DeFatta has found out, insuring a house in this part of New Orleans is virtually impossible.
They can't get a mortgage either.
That is correct. They have to make a choice. Do I build a house here or do I relocate to another area where insurance may be a little bit cheaper and I can afford it? So that is hurting our community. It's taking our people away, the nucleus of this parish, and pulling them away.
3 years after disaster struck, St. Bernard Parish has only a third of its pre-Katrina population. Of course, life has always been dangerous. The real lesson of Katrina, or any big disaster, is that even when we think we're protected against risk, sometimes it turns out we're not. Even making quite modest insurance claims can seem more trouble than it's worth. It leaves you wondering why we bother spending so much on insurance policies every year. Where did this strange habit come from?
Saving up for the proverbial rainy day is the first principle of insurance. But the trick is knowing what to do with your savings, so that unlike in New Orleans after Katrina, they're there in the kitty when you really need them. But to do that, you need to be more than usually canny. And that gives us a valuable clue as to where the history of modern insurance has its origins. Where else but in bonnie, canny Scotland.
They say the Scots are a pessimistic people. Maybe it's the weather, all those hundreds of rainy days. Maybe it's the endless years of sporting disappointment. Or maybe it was the Calvinism we picked up at the time of the Reformation. Certainly, it's two Church of Scotland ministers who deserve the credit for inventing the first true insurance fund back in 1744 and fathering a multi-billion pound industry. The kirkyard of Greyfriars is best known for the grave robbers, the resurrection men, who came here in the late 18th century to supply the medical school at Edinburgh University with corpses for dissection. But Greyfriars' lasting importance comes from the work of the minister here, Robert Wallace, and his friend Alexander Webster.
It's somehow appropriate that it was Scottish ministers who invented modern insurance. After all, we tend to think of them as the embodiment of prudence and thrift, weighed down with an anticipation of impending divine retribution for every tiny transgression. But in fact, Robert Wallace was a hard drinker as well as a mathematical prodigy, who liked nothing better than knocking back magnums of claret with his bibulous buddies.
Wallace and Webster were unhappy at the way the widows and children of their fellow clergymen were treated when the grim reaper struck. They often found themselves homeless and penniless. The plan Wallace and Webster came up with was ingenious, the first true insurance fund in history.
These are some of the voluminous calculations that Robert Wallace did, now housed at the National Archives of Scotland. And you can see how he ran the numbers over and over again, making very careful assumptions about the maximum number of widows and orphans that would have to be provided for. The key point, however, was that from now on, ministers wouldn't just pay money in that would be paid out when one of their number died. Rather, they would pay premiums that would be used to create a fund, and the fund would then be invested for profitable purposes. The widows and orphans henceforth would be paid out of the returns on that money, leaving the premiums to accumulate.
All that was required for the scheme to work was an accurate projection of how many widows and orphans there would likely be in the future. A calculation which Wallace and Webster made with extraordinary precision. The creation of the Scottish Minister's Widows Fund was a milestone in financial history, for it provided a model not just for Scottish clergymen, but for everyone who aspired to provide for life's eventualities.
By 1815, the principle of insurance was sufficiently widespread to be adopted for the widows of men who lost their lives fighting against Napoleon. At the Battle of Waterloo, your chances of getting killed were up to 1 in 4. But at least if you'd taken out insurance, you had the consolation of knowing that your wife and children wouldn't be thrown out onto the street. It gives a whole new meaning to the phrase, take cover.
The Scottish minister's fund grew into the world-famous Scottish Widows. Even novelists, not renowned for their financial prudence, could join. Walter Scott took out a policy in 1826 to reassure his creditors that they'd be paid in the event of his death. By the mid-19th century, being insured was as much a badge of respectability as going to church on Sunday. What no one anticipated back in 1744 was that the careful calculations of two Scottish ministers would grow into today's huge insurance industry.
As Robert Wallace understood 250 years ago, size matters in insurance because the more people are paying into a fund, the easier it becomes, by the law of averages, to predict how much will have to be paid out each year. Although no individual's date of death can be known in advance, actuaries can calculate the likely life expectancy of a large group of individuals with quite astonishing precision.
In other words, insurance is all about trying to cope with the risks of the future. If, that is, you're insured in the first place. No matter how many private funds like Scottish Widows were set up, there were always going to be people beyond the reach of insurance who were either too poor or too feckless to save for that rainy day.
The lot of the poor was once a pretty harsh one, either dependence on private charity or the harsh regime of the workhouse like this typically austere one here in the heart of Edinburgh. Yet by the 1880s, people began to feel that life's losers somehow deserve better. The seed was planted of an entirely new approach to risk, a seed that would ultimately sprout into the modern welfare state. The state system of insurance was designed to exploit the ultimate economy of scale by covering literally every citizen from the cradle to the grave.
Yet while we tend to think of the welfare state as a British invention, in fact, the world's first welfare superpower was Japan. Disaster just kept striking Japan in the first half of the 20th century. In 1923, a huge earthquake devastated Tokyo. As in New Orleans, many private insurance policies turned out to be worth little more than the paper they were printed on. A new idea began to emerge in Japan, that the state should take care of risk. But this was to be state protection allied with imperial ambition. The Japanese set up a welfare state. And they did it to promote warfare. It was the mid-20th century state's insatiable appetite for able-bodied young soldiers and workers, not some kind of bleeding heart altruism, that inspired the rise of welfare. State healthcare would ensure a fitter populace and a steady supply of able-bodied recruits to the Emperor's armed forces and deliver him an empire. The wartime slogan, "All people are soldiers," was adapted to become "All people should have insurance." The only problem was that Japan had gone to war with the world's economic colossus, the United States. Japan's warfare state proved to be a massive mistake. Quite apart from the nearly 3 million lives lost in Japan's doomed bid for empire, by 1945, the value of Japan's entire capital stock seemed to have been reduced to zero by American bombers. Cities built largely out of wood were incinerated. Nearly a third of the urban population lost their homes. Practically the only city to survive intact was Kyoto, the former imperial capital. 1945 may have seen the end of the Japanese warfare state, but it wasn't the end of the Japanese experiment with state-sponsored welfare.
In Japan, as in most combatant countries, the lesson was clear. The world was just too dangerous a place for private insurance markets to cope with. With the best will in the world, people couldn't be expected to insure themselves against the US Air Force. The answer, practically everywhere, was the same: for government to step in effect, to nationalize risk.
Perhaps the most familiar such system of welfare from the cradle to the grave, also born in the ruins of war, was devised by the British economist William Beveridge.
When the Japanese came up with their own comprehensive welfare system in October 1947, their advisory committee on Social Security recommended what amounted to Beveriji no Nihonban, beverage for the Japanese. And yet they went even further than Beveridge had intended, as this copy of their report here in the library of the Japanese National Parliament makes clear. It called on the government to provide against every cause of poverty, sickness and injury, disability, death, childbirth, large families, old age, and unemployment. Whatever the reason, the needy would be guaranteed the minimum standard of living by national assistance. From now on, the Japanese would no longer have to rely on the benevolence of a feudal lord or the luck of the gods. The welfare state would cover them against all the vagaries and vicissitudes of the modern world.
If they couldn't afford education, the state would pay. If they couldn't find work, the state would pay. If they were too ill to work, the state would pay. When they retired, the state would pay. And when they finally died, the state would pay their dependents. So what happened after the war in Japan was merely the extension of the warfare welfare state. The slogan now became, all people should have pensions. The Japanese welfare state seemed to be a miracle of effectiveness. In public health and education, Japan led the world. By the late 1970s, the Japanese could boast that their country had become the welfare superpower.
Run like this, the welfare state seemed to make so much sense. Japan had achieved security for all, the elimination of risk, while at the same time growing so rapidly that by 1968, it had the second largest economy in the world.
One US economist even predicted that Japan's per capita income would overtake America's by the year 2000.
Welfare was working where warfare had failed, to make Japan top nation. The key turned out to be not a foreign empire, but a domestic safety net. And yet there was a catch, a fatal flaw in the design of the post-war welfare state. Just what was it that caused those predictions of Japan's ultimate triumph to fail to come true?
The welfare state looked to be working smoothly enough in 1970s Japan. But elsewhere, there were signs that all was not well. In Britain and throughout the Western world, the welfare state, it seemed, had removed the incentives without which a capitalist economy simply cannot function. The carrot of serious money for those who strive, the stick of hardship for those who are idle. The result was stagflation, low growth, and high inflation. What was to be done? One man and his pupils thought they knew the answer. Thanks in large measure to their influence, one of the great economic trends of the past 25 years has been for the welfare state to be dismantled, reintroducing people with a sharp shock to the unpredictable monster they thought they had escaped from. Risk.